Somebody say, you are glory. One more time, say, you are glorified. With your hands lifted. Sing along. Than a presence
quite
you are sad in.
You are satisfied.
Woo. You can't have it if you won't say it. I want you to say this. Every tear.
Center, Bishop Joseph Vaughn Walker III here, your presiding bishop, and I want to thank God for Bishop William Murphy III, Lady Danielle. I love you all so much. Listen, the Full Gospel Baptist Church Conference is happening in July. I need to see you there, and your pastor is our opening night speaker. Yes, I want to look out and see Dream Center coming by the hundreds, I mean the busloads, plane loads, to be there that night when he says, Dream Center, are you in the house? I want to say, who are all those folk making that noise? And know that you're in the house. It's going to be an incredible 3 days of blessings, great classes. I need to see you there. Hey, join us for Next Is Now. It's happening in New Orleans, Louisiana in the month of July. You don't want to miss it. Register at fullgospelbaptist.org. I'll see you there.
Just any Sunday, but it's first Sunday, and y'all already know how we doing first Sunday. First Sunday, we have church. This is our traditional Sunday. We get all the good throwbacks from our grandmama's church, and we're gonna have a really, really good time. And so, is there anybody that's joining us for the first time today? Anybody joining us for the first time? Raise your hand if you're joining us for the first time. All right, we got a first time friend, Dreamers. Let's clap it up for our first time friends. And if you're joining us online in our online sanctuary, y'all already know we didn't forget about you. Go ahead and drop first time friend in the chat if you're joining us for the first time, because guess what? We have dreamers all across the globe who are excited to greet you. And so if you're in the building, we're going to have you stand up on your feet real quick. Stand up, stand up, stand up. There you go. All right. And so this is our pass the peace moment. And so you're going to find somebody that you do not know. Let's find two people that you do not know. You're going to go over to them and you're going to pass the peace. You're going to let them know that you're happy to see them, that you're looking forward to worshiping with them and all that good stuff. And if you're joining us in our online sanctuary, go ahead and just find two or three names in the chat and just go ahead and we're going to greet our brothers and sisters on YouTube and on Facebook and let them know that we are indeed excited that they're joining us for the worship experience on today. Y'all take a moment. Y'all hug y'all two people. Make sure y'all get their names too. Ask them what their names are. Don't be hugging people and don't know their name. Get your two people. I see y'all greeting. If you coming in the building, we doing pass the peace, y'all. Let's go ahead and greet somebody. Tell them you love them. Tell them you're happy to see them. You're excited to worship with them. All of that good stuff. And then y'all know what we do. We have our get in the ship moment. What's our get in the ship moment? That's our opportunity where we help our partners to get connected with what we're doing here, because we know it only works when we all do it, right? And so for our get in the ship moment, this week we are highlighting passion groups. Yay! Let's clap it up for passion groups. And for those that don't know what passion groups are, Bishop, passion groups are a place to connect, a place to protect, and a place to grow.
Hold on, say that again. Y'all need to say that. It's a what?
A place to connect, a place to protect,
a place to protect,
and a place to grow.
And a place to grow.
And so we get connected based off of our passion. So what do you love to do? What are you called? What did God put you in this earth to do and that you enjoy doing? That's your passion group. That's the person you're going to connect with. And so we have QR codes right behind us so you can take out your phone. Everybody take out your phone. I'm looking at you. Very good. Come on, we got an obedient church. Praise the Lord. All right, I see your phones out. You're going to take your camera out. And even if you got an Android, this should work for you too. Hallelujah, all right? You're going to take your camera out.
And
you're
going to scan Android.
That QR code right there. And if you're having trouble with the QR code, no worries. We got you. We're going to have you text DR Passion Groups with an S to 54244. That's DR Passion Groups with an S to 54244. And then we have a table in the lobby if you want more information. Amen? Amen. All right. Bishop, it's on you, sir.
Listen, we're going to do this really quickly. We have some of our Passion Group facilitators who are in the room. I want them to come to the stage at this time. Those who are leading those passion groups, they are somewhere in the building. All right, come on.
Y'all coming on the stage? Come on.
Y'all come on, give them a better hand clap than that. What passion groups are they leading?
Come on, y'all say your own passion groups. Come on.
Teach me how to pray. Teach me how to pray. Dream girl. Let's learn ASL, the basics, and moms, you have someone precious.
Oh, my goodness.
And healthy foodies.
Healthy foodies. Come on.
Listen, what we're doing is we're creating smaller communities within this mega community so that you never get lost in your church and it always feels like your family church. Will you stretch your hands this way? Let's pray for them. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you that the same grace that you have given to me to lead this church, that you will give them that same grace to lead every passion group, that the passion group will never be about their personality, but it will remain not just about their passion, but about the passion of Christ. And so, Father, we give you praise for how you will use this group to grow our church. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, amen and amen and amen. Will you help me thank God for our passion group leaders? I do want to thank God for Pastor Tim, who had to run out and check on Pastor Shan, who had a little bit of a health challenge. We want to pray for her this week. But if you'll notice that there was only one man that would have been on this stage, I need some other brothers to plug into passion groups so that you can become a passion group leader. Will you help me thank God again for our passion groups and for the leads? Come on.
Good afternoon.
afternoon, dreamers. We're getting ready to give. Somebody give God praise for that. We're getting ready to sow good seed into good soil. It is a blessing. Before we give, I want to read this passage of scripture into your hearing. It comes to us in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 10. It says, now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food, what? Will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in what? Oh, I need a church this afternoon. You will be enriched in what? Scripture says you will be enriched in everything for all liberality, which through us is producing thanksgiving to God. Look at your neighbor and say, he will give seed to the sower. He'll give seed to the sower. Listen, we've got a few different ways in which we're able to give, a few different areas that we sow into. Before we do that, I want to just kind of share a personal testimony. 2 weeks ago, we were coming into our Super Sunday. Anybody excited about the harvest that's connected to your seed that you were able to, that's it, put in the ground? Well, as we were coming into that Super Sunday, I know what the Lord had postured in my heart to give, but I told the Lord, I say, Lord, I ain't gonna have it to give unless you give it to me to give. And what do you know? Just like God, he provided seed to the sower. His word is true. And exactly what he told me I would be able to sow is exactly what he put in my hand to do. And so I just believe even today, as we trust God with our seed, as we trust God with the desire to sow, he will then give seed to the sower. The first area that we sow, we give our tithe. It is 10% of all of our increase. It's one dime on every dollar. Somebody shout, one dime at a time. One dime at a time. That we also give our over and above seed is led by the Spirit of God. We give liberally in that way. And thirdly, we're able to sow directly into the life of our pastor in what we call our pastor's love offering. We believe when we do all of those things, that what happens in Philippians 4:19, it becomes our portion. Our God shall supply all of our needs according to his riches in glory. We got a few different ways that we can make that happen. Two brand new ways we want to introduce to you. We've been rolling it out over the past few weeks. If you're in the physical space, if you're in the room right now, if you're in the sanctuary, you can look on the back of the pew. There are two QR codes. One of those QR codes will link you directly to our giving options. The second way is our text to give. You can text any amount to 84321. So if you're giving $2 million today, somebody was supposed to shout right there. If you're giving $2 million today, all you got to do is text $2 million to 84321. Even in the online sanctuary, we invite you to give. Right underneath me are the options and the ways by which you can give. Each week before we give, we make a strong confession. We make a confession over a faith over our seed, believing God for the harvest that is connected to it. Y'all ready, dreamers? Let's do it. We are the Dream Center Church of Atlanta, a praying church, a worshiping church, a generous church, called to change the world's expectation of the church. We believe in the vision, we believe in the visionary, and we believe that what? Both are good ground. So we bring the tithe, we give a free will offering, and we sow a love offering because we believe. Let's all say it. We believe that in response to our obedience concerning our finances, what's happening? The favor of God is exploding. Let's say that again. The favor of God. The favor of God is exploding over our lives. We believe God is raising up somebody somewhere who will use their power, their resources, their influence, and their affluence to help us. Let's say it. Because I am a tither, because I am a giver, I have access to what? Doors. Doors of opportunity. Doors of promotion. Doors of increase. Doors of overflow. What kind of doors? God doors. It's in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Let's seal that with a praise right here. Glory to God. Listen, we invite you now to come and lay your seed on the altar. Even if you're giving with your mobile device, come and make a point of contact as you stand in faith for the harvest connected to this seed. Contagious is getting ready to lead us. I want you to look at somebody, tell them, say this and that. I put it all in his hands. Let's go. Yeah.
can handle your sin, I put it all in his hand. Come on, somebody say, not some of it, not a little bit of it, not half of it, but I've learned to put it all.
Dreamers, can we give God praise for this living legend who is one of our own, evangelist Dorothy Norwood? She's getting ready to lead us in our communion hymn, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross.
Hey. How many want to be near the cross today? How many want to stay near the cross? Listen, Jesus, keep me near the cross. There's a precious, precious. It's free, free to all. My God, a healing. Anybody need a healing today? A healing stream. You know what? It flows from care. Oh!
on somebody. Tell them you're going to find your rest this week. I need you to put your hand on them. Tell them you're going to find rest this week. I ain't saying you're going to die this week. I'm saying you're going to be at rest.
Somebody say rest. Jesus was in the upper room with his disciples. He knew what was to come. So he took the bread. The bread represented his body that was bruised and torn just for us. The Bible said he took the bread, broke it, and blessed it, and gave it unto them, saying, "This is my body, which was given for you. You may take and eat."
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And what can make me whole again? Oh, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Took the cup which was filled with wine, the wine representing the blood of Jesus. Do I have any grateful people for the blood on today? The Bible says that he took the cup, he blessed it, and he gave it unto them, saying, "This is my blood which was shed for you. You may take and you may drink." Can I just get you to thank him for the blood on today?
Thank you.
God for the name. I wonder if there's anybody in the room who's ever had to drop the name. Y'all, some folk name drop other names, but somebody will say, I got in trouble one day and I name dropped the name of Jesus and things started getting better for me. Somebody drop his name real quick. Just touch your neighbor, tell him, I drop a Jesus in that situation. I drop a Jesus over your body. I drop a Jesus over your family. I drop a Jesus over your child. Somebody drop the name. Just to worship the Lord. Just remember, worship is when we... Yes, Lord. Worship is not about what he's done. Worship is about who he is. Somebody just lift up your hands and just call the name of the Lord in this place. More than anything. Lord, I love you. More than anything. You need to set that going into the week. Lord, I love you. You need to set that as the bar. More than anything. More than anything. One more time, church. Lord, I love you. You clap your hands and give the Lord a praise in this room. I need you to clap your hands and give the Lord a praise in the room. I need you to clap your hands. I don't hear you saying much. I need you to clap your hands and say something. Somebody give him praise. Don't think it, say it. This is not a moment of meditation. It's a moment of declaration. You gotta say it. My. Yes, Lord. Will you do me a favor, since it's first Sunday, we've been a little old school. Will you just reach over and grab your neighbor's hand? I want you to just take a moment and pray for them. Just, we didn't have an altar call like they used to do, but just altars are all over this room. Altars are, yes, Lord. Altars are everywhere in this room. Just grab your neighbor's hand and squeeze it and pray in the Holy Ghost. You don't have to know their story. Holy Spirit already does. You don't have to know what they're dealing with. You don't have to know what they're going through. Just, I pray for you now, that as you make God your priority this week, I pray that God would make your problem his. Just squeeze that neighbor's hand. I want you to pray that this week would be a peaceful week. Come on, you have authority. Say it. I decree. Say it. I decree. This week will be a peaceful week for you. Look at them so they'll know you're praying for them. Look them in the eye. Tell them, I decree this week will be a joyful week for you. And whatever happens to you this week, you will not lose your joy. Say it. Say what I just said. Make that your prayer for your neighbor. I pray that whatever comes up against you this week, that in all things you will prosper. Squeeze that hand. Tell them, I speak health over your body. Squeeze that hand. Tell them, I speak health over your mind. This first week of April, it'll be drama free. Don't say yeah, say what I said. This first week of April, you can't have it if you won't say it. Say it. This, y'all write it down in the online sanctuary. This first week of April, drama free. Drama free. Matter of fact, lay your hand on your neighbor one more time. Just tell him, I speak a stress-free week over you. You ain't stressing over nothing this week. Say it. Say it just like I said it, real ghetto-like. Write it down for me, Lisa. Liz, write it down. Keisha, I ain't stressing over nothing this week. I'm not just speaking over your week, I'm speaking over mine. Can I be honest with you? I was stressing this week. Can I be honest with you? I was in my feelings this week. Some stuff going on, couldn't think straight. I was praying around what I would preach today, and the Lord said, I don't want you to preach. And I said, well, who gonna preach then? And he said, you text Dr. Tony Alvarado. I said, Lord, it's Saturday. I text her. This is how you do. I text big sister. Are you in town tomorrow? Said, I'm exhausted and I need somebody to preach, and you were on my heart. She said, I'll be there at 9:30. So I wanted to publicly just thank you for obeying the voice of God. She's already ministered once to me, and I know that she's going to minister to you. Will you stretch your hands towards this woman of God and just say, Holy Spirit, use Dr. Tony Alvarado to speak to my soul, and I'll give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. She walks with her husband, Bishop Jonathan Alvarado, at the Grace Church, and she's got a word for us today. Will you receive my big sister, Dr. Tony Alvarado?
How many know that sometimes God needs to restore our soul? How many know that we need God to restore our soul? How many know that pastors get tired? Shepherds get tired. And I'm appreciative of this moment to be able to come and stand in this place and to help my brother. Amen. Just go a little further. Amen. Help my sister. Will you help me thank God again for your pastor, your bishop, Bishop William Murphy. We bless you. You cannot celebrate him without celebrating her. Pastor D, my sister, thank you, Lord. Y'all stop the clock for 2 seconds so I can just say my little greetings, and then y'all can put me on the clock. Amen. Amen. The bishop said, we got time in this service. Amen. That's some of y'all done slept all night and slept in this morning. Amen. But I want to just say one thing about the Murphys before I go into my message on today. I want to thank God for them. I wasn't at New Birth when the Murphys showed up. I moved to this city at the age of 25 from the south side of Chicago. Where my south side people? I was 25 years old, and I happened upon a little church on Snapfinger Road in Decatur, Georgia. Didn't know who I was, didn't know my purpose, didn't know what God had called me to do, but I was in search of myself and bumped into my destiny. Sitting in that church was where I met my husband, Bishop Alvarado. I remember the night that they introduced him as the minister of music, Bishop Long, the late pastor Bishop Long, introduced him to the church that night, and I asked the question, what kind of name is Alvarado? When I took him home to meet my family in Chicago, my grandmother said, is that boy a Rican? I said, yes, Grandma, he's a Rican. Columbus, Ohio Rican, amen. I say all that to say you never know where destiny will lead you. You never know what God will do. When I was serving as the worship leader at New Birth Missionary Baptist Church, that was before the days they were paying psalmists and worship leaders. We just served. Amen. Because we loved God and we loved God's church. But as Whaley's on the way, as your pastor came on the scene, it was just a breath of fresh air to watch what God did with him as he came on the scene. And I want you to know that I am so proud of your pastor. I see him. That's right. Don't let nobody talk about your pastor in the barbershop, in the hair salon, on Twitter, TikTok, or nowhere else. Amen. But I just thank God for him. I thank God for his lovely wife. I'm so proud of him. I'm proud to call him my little brother. But more than that, I'm proud to call him a colleague in the city. And so I honor the gift of grace that is in him on today. I'm going to preach this morning just one text, if you will, one verse out of the text, out of Mark's Gospel, chapter 16. And if you will go there with me. In my church, we stand for the reading of the word. And I won't have you stand long because it's only one passage, only one verse. But I believe that after we read the verse and we tell the story, that God's word would have been preached in here today. Amen. Mark's Gospel, chapter 16, verse number 9. Now when he rose on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast 7 demons. Thus far the scripture. Before you take your seat, would you just herald my subject to about 3 people around you? I've been delivered for a purpose. Tell at least 3 people before you take your seat. I've been delivered for a purpose. You can take your seats. I dare not go further without paying homage to my husband, Bishop Alvarado, and our church there, Grace Church International. They are praying for me even in this very moment as he is preaching and I'm preaching here. And so I thank God for him and our church there. This particular text this morning, as this is the second week or the second Sunday in the liturgical calendar, this is known as the second Sunday of Easter. I know last Sunday was Resurrection Sunday, and we celebrated the resurrection of our Lord, but sometimes we move too fast past experiences. And sometimes God wants us to sit in a moment and to think about a thing and to think about a matter so we don't just press pass and move on to the next thing. How many know that God is up to something even in this very hour? This particular text that I read on this morning comes out of the Gospel of Mark. I'm very interested in this particular passage because Mark, like many of the gospel writers, highlights some of the women who were a part of Jesus's ministry team. These women that followed him, these women who served with him, these gospel women like Luke names, Joanna, Mary Magdalene, Susanna. These gospel writers take time to note the specificity of women, letting us know that the kingdom of God is made up of men and women from all walks of life that span a great sector of experiences, social and economic strata. However, in the text, we get several women that we don't get their name, and every now and then we get a woman or a man and we get to understand who they are by their name. I particularly am interested in this gospel because Mark is the shortest of all gospels, being the shortest of the gospel writers and the oldest account of the life and ministry of Jesus, writes with urgency, using words like immediately and straightway. Mark doesn't waste time. He gets right to the point. And he goes not like Luke's gospel, who goes with much detail. Mark does not spend much time in the Sanhedrin court like Matthew. Mark does not give any attention to the restoration of Peter like John does. No, Mark says, this is what happened. He cuts right to the chase. He does not pontificate. Jesus is arrested. He's brought before Pilate. He's chosen over a thief, Barabbas. The soldiers mock him. He's crucified, buried in a tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. And Mary Magdalene, the mother of Joseph, is observing where he lay. Mark moves swiftly through the drama, and he takes time to let us know some important facts and nuances about the resurrection. Mark says he appears first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom seven demons were cast out. I ask the question, why would he put this nuance in there? Why is this important? And why do we have to get this detail about her life? Why do we get her backstory? How could it be why couldn't he just say that he appeared first to Mary Magdalene? And he could have just stopped there. He appeared first to Mary, who had been one of his disciples. Or he could have listed all the things that she had done as a part of Jesus's ministry team. But no, Mark goes further to let us know something about her background and her story. He helps us to understand a little bit of her struggle. Jesus has been crucified, and every detail of scripture has now been fulfilled. I told them in the early service that it's important to note that every aspect of Jesus's life, from his birth to the resurrection, was a fulfillment of prophecy. In fact, Jesus, Matthew, being a Jewish writer, is interested in the fulfillment of prophecy. So all throughout Matthew's gospel, you'll find this words, and all this was done that it might be fulfilled. Matthew inserts an agenda and assigns a motive to God's orchestration of life's events, citing prophetic significance. This episode doesn't just take place by happenstance, but it is for a dramatic or a prophetic effect. This account is not just told as a retelling of a historical fact, but it helps us to understand that your life and my life and our life's events unfold as a part of God's revelation for God's divine purposes in the earth.
In other words, it doesn't matter where you came from. It doesn't matter if your mama knew your daddy. It doesn't matter what your pedigree was. The fact that you are here means that you are a word spoken out of the mouth of God. And just like he told Jeremiah, I knew you before you were in your mother's womb. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. So it doesn't matter what happened between the time I spoke you into existence and the time you walked into your purpose. I called you for such a time as this, Esther, and who knows whether you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. This event in Mary's life, this event is an unfolding of what God had purposed for her before the very foundation of the world. Paul picks up on this injunction when he talks about our life in the spirit and helps us to know, and we know. Come on, Bible readers. All things, not some things, not a few things, but all, everybody holler, all things work together for good, not just for your good, but for good, for the good, for God's divine purposes in the earth. God is like a master ecologist. God is reconstituting all of the brokenness of your life and my life for his divine purposes and plans in the earth. See, too often we allow the drama of our lives to obscure the substance of what God is trying to accomplish in and through us. I heard Bishop Murphy when he said that he's declaring that we would have a drama-free week. But the truth of the matter is every now and then drama happens. But you look at your neighbor and say, life just be lifing. Come on, come on. Touch somebody else around you and tell them, life just be lifing. It doesn't matter how spiritual you are, how many tongues you speak in, how many Bible verses you can quote. Life, come on somebody, just be life. And every now and then life will deal you some stuff that you didn't see coming. Oh, come on somebody. Every now and then life will punch you in the gut. Come on now. Every now and then life will trip you. You ain't saying nothing to me. Life, just be lifing. And the truth of the matter is, oftentimes we allow the drama of life to obscure our vision and the substance of what God is trying to accomplish in and through our lives. Touch your neighbor and tell them what's happening in your life is happening for a reason. Come on. Come on, tell somebody else around you, it's happening for a reason. Come on. You see, God often uses the circumstances and the situations of our lives to ground us and to center us right smack dab in the middle of his will. Jesus' death and resurrection was a calculated series of events that points to the fulfillment of prophecy. This penultimate event in Jesus' life demonstrates for us the weight that God places on his word and on prophecy and its fulfillment. Prophecy, beloved, is bound to purpose. God sends a prophetic word over our lives as a signpost that points us toward God's divine purposes for our lives. And see, you're not here. I told him in the earlier service, and it bears repeating, you're not just here to suck up air. Oh, Lord, have mercy. You didn't survive the accident just to meander around aimlessly. Come on now. You didn't come through cancer just to be cute. Somebody in here this morning know what I'm talking about. Somebody here this afternoon needs to know that you survived whatever you survived because God still has a purpose and a plan for your life. I just came to encourage three people around you this morning. Maybe that wasn't for you. Maybe that was just for your neighbor. But would you tell somebody around you the fact that you're still here? After all that you've been through, come on, touch somebody and tell them the fact that you're still alive. Come on now. After all that you've been through, come on. We ain't got time for you to tell everything that you've been through. But would you look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, the fact that I'm in the room this morning, Come on, the fact that I can lift my hands, the fact that I can open up my mouth. Oh, come on, somebody. The fact, come on, somebody. Touch your neighbor and say, that's why cancer couldn't kill you. That's why the accident couldn't take you out. The divorce couldn't make you go crazy. The betrayal and folk deserting you didn't stop you from fulfilling God's purpose and plan for your life. Oh, Lord, have mercy. See, the late Dr. Miles Monroe taught us for years. He taught us on purpose and destiny for years. He said this. He said, the two most significant days in our lives are this: the day you were born and the day you find out why you were born. Oh, Lord, have mercy. He said that there are two dates that you need to remember. Tell your neighbor, there's two things you need to remember: the day you were born and the day that you find out why you were born. Because, see, when you find out why, see, the person who knows what to do will always have a job, but the person who knows why will always own the business. You got to answer the why question. Come on, somebody. You got to answer the why question. Come on now. You got to be able to answer the why question. Would you look at your neighbor and say, come on, touch your neighbor and say, you got to answer the why question. You got to find out why you were born. Come on now. You got to tap into God's purpose and destiny for your life. Would you touch somebody around you and tell them, the devil should have killed me while he had a chance? But he fooled around and let me find out why. Come on now. He fooled around and let me find out why. Come on now. He fooled around and let me walk up into the Dream Center and hear this black woman from the south side of Chicago by way of Conyers, Georgia, help me figure out why. Come on, touch your neighbor and say, he should have killed me while he had a chance. I believe somebody ought to give him a praise right there. I feel a praise in the room right there. I feel a real crazy praise right there. I want you to give God a why praise right now. I want you to open up your mouth. Come on, come on. Come on, open up your mouth. Come on, and give him a why praise. Come on, come on. I don't know why Jesus loves me. I don't know why he cares. I don't know why he sacrificed his life, but oh, I'm glad. Listen, so this moment, this glorious moment, is not just for Jesus. This moment is for Mary. Mary is also known as Mary of Magdala or Mary of Magdalene. She's named for the town in which she was birthed, or the town in which she came from. She came from a fishing town on the western shore of the Sea of Galilee. Jesus loved her dearly and included her and many other women as a part of his ministry team. Mary Magdala was so respected that a short book called The Gospel of Mary was written likely about 100 years after Jesus' resurrection. She's the last to stay with Jesus at his execution, but she's the first to discover the empty tomb. I love it because Luke says that while everybody else left the scene, it was the women that stayed around. I know it ain't Women's Day, but let me help the girls out this morning. Oh, Lord, have mercy. I love it because you can't do nothing with a woman when she make up her mind to see something all the way through. Do I have any girls in the room right now? You know how to see it all the way through. Oh, Lord, have mercy. She's the first to discover the empty tomb. She's the first to hear about the resurrection. She's the first to see and talk with the resurrection Lord. And she's the first to be called out and sent to tell others the good news of his resurrection. Thus, some scholars will call her the first apostle. Some would say that she was the 13th disciple. She was often accurately called the Apostle of Apostles.
But let me back up, because we know all of this because on the back end, we know it. But on that chilly morning, Mary didn't know she was being set up for greatness. Somebody needs to know that you're being set up for greatness right now. Somebody ought to get excited right now. Just touch three people and say, it's a setup, it's a setup. Come on, tell somebody else that don't believe it, it's a setup. Come on, tell them what you're dealing with right now, it's a setup. It's a setup. As a matter of fact, she's come through a terrible experience. She stood at the foot of a bloody cross. She's watched as the one whom she had been following for 3 years as one of his disciples, arrested, tried in three courts, chosen to be sentenced to death by crucifixion, beaten, whipped, stripped, cursed, spat upon, humiliated, and dragged through the city carrying his own cross. And ultimately to be hung for the whole world to see him die a criminal's death. We shouted last week about this resurrection glory. We shouted about this resurrection power. But I need you to know the resurrection costs something. Oh, Lord, this wasn't no cute thing. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. See, everybody want a resurrection, but nobody wants to die. Everybody want to claim healing, but nobody wants to be sick. Everybody want peace, but don't nobody want to go through any confusion. But is there anybody here that know that what you, your peace costs you something? Would you touch your neighbor and say, my peace costs me something? Come on, touch somebody else and say, this anointing costs me something. This ministry cost me something. Come on. This assignment cost me something. And that's why, come on now, that's why I'm not going to let you take my peace, because it cost me. Is there anybody in here that you want to guard your peace right now? Touch your neighbor and say, I got to guard my peace because it cost me. It costs to see the glory. See, here's the thing. See, you see the glory on people, but you don't know their story. You see the reward, but you don't see the sacrifice. You see the healing, but you don't see the sickness. You see the elevation, but you don't see the humiliation. But Mary of Magdala, the Bible says she went through something to get to this point. She went through something. She didn't just wake up here. She had to go through something. She had to watch her dream die. She had to watch, always saying nothing to me, while the thing that she had been following for 3 long years, come on now, the thing that she had given all of her life for, she had to watch it die on a whole rugged cross. It cost her something. When she went to the tomb early in the morning, the Bible says it was dark when she got out there. It was early in the morning. Can you imagine her having to step over graves and dead bodies to get to her assignment? Because she had gone home to get the spices. Come on, somebody. So she can come back and anoint his body. I wonder, is there anybody in here that want to protect your praise right now? The Bible says she had gone to get spices to anoint his body because she recognized her assignment. And every now and then, beloved, you got to go back and get something to protect your assignment. It costs her something. It costs her something. It costs her something. And it's important that you need to know this. He's crucified. He's buried in Joseph of Arimathea's tomb. And the Bible says when she gets there that morning, she came to anoint his body. But when she got there, she discovered something. That the thing that she came to anoint wasn't there. My husband taught us like this. Don't let nobody anoint you to stay dead. That wasn't me. That was Bishop Alvarado. He told us last week. Don't let nobody anoint you to stay dead. She was coming to anoint a dead thing. But she didn't know that he had gotten up.
Oh, Lord, have mercy. I like it because this is a glorious moment. As when she gets there, she finds that he has risen as he said. John's gospel said, now Mary stood outside of the tomb crying and weeping. She's bent over and she's looking into the tomb. She sees two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. And they asked the woman, why are you crying? She said, they've taken away my Lord, and I don't know where they put him. And she turns around and sees Jesus standing there. The Bible says that she is excited, so excited that she goes now to hug him. She says, Rabbi, when he calls her name, she didn't recognize him until he called her name. But when he called her name, that's a sermon right there. When he called her name, come on, somebody. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Because there's something about the voice of Jesus. He said, my sheep, come on, know my voice, and a stranger's voice. Y'all ain't gonna help me preach this thing. But on that resurrection morning, when she met Jesus in the garden, the Bible says she was disoriented. She was dismayed. She didn't recognize him. But when he spoke her name, she understood who he was. Let this woman now be a paradigm for us this morning. Mary Magdala, as she's coming to the tomb, she did not allow her drama to keep her from coming. She didn't allow her issues or her pain or her past. She didn't allow death or grief or her stuff keep her at home. Ah, Lord, have mercy. She didn't allow past relationships, failures, or the opinions of people keep her from her assignment. Her story is our story. Her triumph is our triumph. Her victory is our victory. Mark could have ended the story right there, but he tells us this little fact, that he appeared to a woman who had a past. He appeared to the woman who had seven demons cast out of her. Not just any woman, but a woman with a story. A woman with a past. Come on, somebody. A woman with a struggle. A woman with a mess going on in her life. A woman who's been through some stuff. I know you got your church clothes on and you don't want nobody to know it, but I believe there's a few of us in the room right now that don't mind your neighbor knowing that you got a past. Come on. Touch your neighbor and say, yeah, yeah, yeah. Come on. Touch your neighbor and say, come on now. I got a past. I got some struggles. I got some mess going on right now. Come on. I've been through some stuff. Come on. Say, I've been through the storm. And I've been through the rain. I've been up. Come on. I've been down. I've been leveled to the ground. Come on. Touch your neighbor. Say, neighbor, you don't know like I know what the Lord has delivered me out of. Say, neighbor, if I told you all the things that God has delivered me out of, you might not want to sit by me this morning. But you need to know, come on, I've been delivered for a purpose. Come on. Say, neighbor, I've been delivered for a purpose. I've been delivered for God's divine purpose. Been delivered for an assignment. Come on, say, neighbor, I'm gonna give God praise right now for my deliverance. Come on, open up your mouth and give him praise. Come on, give him glory. Give him glory. Don't allow sickness. Don't allow pain. Don't allow past. Don't allow death, grief. To keep you where you are, because God has delivered you for a purpose. Somebody tell of his goodness. Tell of his mercy. Tell of his grace. I said, clap your hands. Leap for joy. You ought to be a witness. Because when Mary ran out, the Bible says she ran out and she he found the brethren. He told her, go tell Peter, go tell the brethren that I have risen as I said. Come on, open up your mouth and say, neighbor, you caught me in the middle of my story. God still got a work for me to do. God still got an assignment on my life. Come on, touch your neighbor. Say, neighbor, I'm here because God's not through with me yet. Open up your mouth and give him praise right now. I said, give him glory. I said, give him honor. If you've been set free, give God a praise right now. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. He who has been delivered out of the hand of the enemy. I said, give him glory. Give him praise. Because he enlisted you for his service. He delivered you to tell a dying world that Jesus saves. That Jesus is real. That Jesus is a deliverer. That he's able to keep that which I have committed unto him. He's able. Open up your mouth and give him praise. I said, give him glory. If you know you've been delivered, if you know you've been set free, clap those hands. Leap for joy. Tell somebody, say, as a matter of fact, come on, God is using my story. God is using what I've been through. God is using everything I've gone through. Give him praise right now. Who would have thought? Who would have thought that a woman that had seven demons her would have been the very woman that Jesus commissioned to go tell his disciples he has risen as he said. Don't you ever let anybody convince you that God can't use you because of what you've been in or what you've come out of or what you've been through. This woman who had seven demons cast out of her, Bishop, became one of the greatest evangelists ever known to man. The text says she ran out, found Peter and the other disciples. Peter, who denied him. Thomas, who would doubt him. Y'all ain't gonna help me. They had given up. They were ready to go back fishing. They thought it was over. But how many know it ain't over until God says it's over? Stand up all over this sanctuary. Touch your neighbor and say, it ain't over until God says it's over. See, the problem with you and I, we don't know. See, we catch people in the middle of their story. Who would have thought that a woman with seven demons cast out of her would have been the one to rehabilitate Peter? Y'all know Peter denied him, right? And Peter was so disappointed in himself because Peter had pledged his life. He told Jesus, when Jesus was saying all that, the Son of Man have come to die,
Peter, y'all know Peter was that cussing disciple. He would cut you. He cut a man's ear off. He told him, no, you ain't, they ain't coming to get you. Peter, but when they asked Peter, was he with him? The text said he didn't just deny him one time. He denied him three times. After the resurrection, Peter is disappointed in himself. Mary goes and rehabilitates Peter. Get up from there. I know you did what they said you did, but you're not who they say you are. I just want to tell somebody, get up, get up, get up. Look at somebody around you and tell them, get up, get up, get up. Get up, God still got work for you to do. Get up, God still got a word. Come on, get up, God still got a word in your mouth. Get up! Get up, Peter! God still want to use you. Has she not been in place? Maybe we wouldn't have had such a day of Pentecost where Peter stands up and gives the first sermon of the church and 3,000 souls added to the church in one day. Because Mary, who had been delivered with 7 demons out of her, ran and told Peter and the other disciples. He has risen as he said. So whatever you've come out of and whatever you've been through, you've been delivered for a purpose. God still want to use you. God still has a plan. God still has a purpose for your life. Now, your assignment is to find out why. Find out what God wants to do in you. Can I help, Pastor? If you're a member of this church, God didn't just send you in here to look, be a spectator. God didn't send you here for your own comfort and enjoyment. He's got an assignment attached to your life. That's why no matter what you've been through, God can still use you. Who would have thought? A woman with 7 demons cast out would have been later named the 13th apostle. Who can anything good come out of the south side of Chicago? Who would have thought a woman whose mama got pregnant as a teenager, dropped out of high school, whose daddy died when she was 5 years old, that God would use her to preach the gospel? I don't know what your story is, and you don't know all of my story, but I want you to know that God's got a purpose and a plan. What we have to do is offer it up to Him in worship. Offer up our lives as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto Him, which is our reasonable service, our spiritual worship. Would you just lift those hands all over the sanctuary? To worship you, I live. To worship you, I live. To worship you. To worship you, I live.
Begins in your mind. There it is. Just say it. Deliverance begins in my mind. Just Come on, just say it. Deliverance begins in my mind. Just matter of fact, I want you to just speak for yourself. Don't wait for nobody. Somebody might touch you. Somebody might pray for you. But if nobody touches you, if nobody stands in front of you to pray for you, I just want you to speak this over your life. I am free indeed. Say it again. I am free indeed. Say it again. I am free indeed. Lay your hand on your own head. Say, free in my mind. Lay your hands on yourselves. Tell yourself, free in my mind. Lay your hands on your heart. Say, I'm free in my will. I declare you're not leaving here prisoner to your emotions. You are not leaving here prisoner to your feelings. And your behavior will not be dictated by how you feel. Your behavior is going to be a reflection of your faith. Woo! Say what I just said. My behavior is going to be a reflection of my faith. I'm going to do what I believe. Throw your hands up. Just lift your hands and just receive that. There are many of you. Listen, I got to kill two birds with one stone because the devil is, I caught, see, devil, you ain't slick. I know you. Some of you were about to run out of this room, and maybe you don't necessarily need deliverance, but you need connection. And the devil about to trick you. He telling you right now, if you leave now, you get in front of the traffic. Because he's trying to keep you from connecting with this anointing that is critical for what God is trying to do in your life. You need a pastor. You need a church. Get down to this altar right now. Come on, get your stuff. Get your stuff. Matter of fact, Tia, y'all get somebody. Get your stuff. I want you to come right up in this choir stand. Those of you, you need a church. You need covering. Get your stuff and come now. I gotta take just a moment and minister to those of you who are at this altar, because for many of you, your issue is your thinking. And all this week, the devil's been fighting you in your mind. You can't stay free because you don't think free. Your thoughts keep taking you back to your past. Throw your hands up. Y'all come in close. Y'all come close. Throw your hands up. Throw your hands up. I decree and declare that you are free in your mind. Some of you need to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Oh my goodness, I wasn't trying to go here today. Listen, just throw your hands up. Throw your hands up. Keep your hands up. Keep your hands up. Your problem is you keep putting your hands on it. Throw your hands up. Throw your hands up. Throw your hands up. As a prophetic decree, we already sang it. I put it all in his hands. Well, why are you going to keep putting your hands on it then? You got to take your hands off of it. Throw your hands up and let God have it. Pray this prayer with me right now. Say, Holy Spirit, baptize me again. I want you to listen real clearly. Those of you who have never spoken in an unknown tongue, the Spirit of God is dictating a language to you that you have never spoken before. It is a prayer language. It is a language that when you get in your feelings and you start speaking this language, it's going to align your thoughts and your heart with the Word of God and with the will of God. You need a second language. That's your problem. Throw your hands up and receive that. That's the Spirit of God ministering to you in a fresh way. And if you will listen clearly, you will hear a language that you have never spoken before. And by faith, I want you to open your mouth and speak what you hear. Do it right now. Do it right now. Do it right now. Don't think yourself out of this moment. Don't think yourself out of this moment, and don't you let the devil get you in fear. You don't have to fear this. This is not spooky. It's not weird. It's not crazy. It is the gift of God, so that when you are communicating with God, you don't have the interruption of your flesh. Come on, open your mouth. Open your mouth. Open your mouth and speak. Open your mouth and speak. Open your mouth and speak. Many of you are being baptized in the Holy Ghost. God's given you a prayer language. So when you run out of English, you don't run out of words. So that when you run out of English, you don't stop praying, because you kick into that second gear and you begin praying in the Holy Ghost. Do it now. 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 God, I give you praise. I give you praise. I need somebody. Y'all, can y'all help me just a moment? Everybody in this room, I need you praying in tongues. Everybody. Everybody. Those of you in the online sanctuary and you desire this gift, it's a simple prayer. Holy Spirit, baptize me again. There are many who argue this. Dr. Alvarado just brought it up. There are many who argue this. But if you go back and search the text, that there were 3,000 people who got saved in one day. But there was also another group of folks who spoke in tongues before they joined church. They didn't join church to the end of the chapter. They spoke in tongues at the beginning of the chapter. I want to say to you, you are at the beginning of your second chapter. And if you would just believe, God has given you a gift. Come on, everybody, speak, speak, speak. You need this language. So when you get back to your house and you looking at your situation and it look like it's the same, you got another language that you can speak before your feelings start dictating your behavior. Hey! Oh my! I decree and declare that you are free in deeds, that your behavior from this moment forward will be a reflection of your freedom. That your behavior from this, write it down for me, Lisa Reeves. My behavior from this moment forward will be a reflection of my faith in Jesus' name. Somebody clap your hands and help me praise God. People are being baptized in the Holy Ghost all across this altar. I need a better hand clap than that. People are being baptized in the Spirit all across this altar. Somebody say, free. In my mind, in my will, how I feel, free. In my mind, in my will, how I feel, free. You can't have it if you won't say it. Say, I'm free in my mind, in my will. I agree. Let's do this. Every one of you who are on the altar, every one of you who are on the altar, I want you to grab the hand of that person standing next to you. As a matter of fact, everybody, I don't know how y'all do it in the online sanctuary, but y'all grab a hold of each other. Grab each other's name. I don't know how y'all do it, but grab somebody. Everybody touching somebody. I just want you to pray this simple prayer. Say, I agree. And I call it done. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen. Now come on, clap your hands and help me praise him. Clap your hands and help me praise him. It's already done. I said I want you to praise him like it's already done. Come on, praise him like it's already. Praise him like it's already done. I gotta circle back here. I got to circle back here. Not a lot of you moved. I want you to look at your neighbor really quickly and ask them, who's your pastor? Look at them. You're still looking at me. Ask the person next to you, who's your pastor? Who's your pastor? You got to be clear. It's a bunch of bishops nowadays. Who's your pastor? Who? I hear you. I hear you. I hear you, mommy. Listen, who? Ask your neighbor, what church do you belong to? Your neighbor looked at you like, what's the name of this church? There's lying. Come on. Come on. Listen. This is where I got to do this. Hold on, y'all. It's too much moving. Hold on. Pause for a moment. People are making decisions for Jesus. We don't walk out when people are making decisions for Jesus. We don't demonstrate to people, I could care less about your soul. So while you're making a decision for Jesus, I'm walking out to my car. We don't do that. Look at somebody and tell them, I'm saved. I don't do that. Look at the people in the aisles. Tell them, you saved. You don't do that. There are people who are making decisions for Jesus. Will you help me? I need a better hand clap than that. People are making decisions. Welcome home, baby. Somebody say, welcome home. Welcome home. Will you do me a favor real quick? Ask your neighbor again. What church did you say you belong to? What church was that? What church did they say? They said this church? People are walking. People are responding to the call of God. You need a pastor. We know you're not perfect. We know you still wrestling with some demons. So are we. Come on. This is the people are walking out of the balcony, y'all. Help me praise God. Come on, I want y'all to go right to the choir stand. Y'all go straight to the choir stand. Come on, go. Just go straight. Somebody help me lead them to the choir stand. Come on. Thank you. Come on, y'all. Is that everybody? Is that everybody? We got two sides. They can walk up either side. Don't make it hard. Just get them in the choir stand. Come on. Is that everybody? No, that's not everybody. There's somebody standing around you who is disconnected from the body of Christ. There's somebody standing around you who's connected to the wrong community. And let me say this to you, whether you realize it or not, I know we don't look at it this way, but whatever community you are connected to, it is a community of faith. Because they believe something. Question is what they believe connected to your purpose? I'm not telling you to leave nobody's church. We don't do that. We don't fish in other churches. But there are people who are connected to circles of friends who are not on the path of Christianity. And y'all got to watch it because it's a lot of spiritual folk. But those spirits ain't holy. Are you listening to me? You're connected to people who are spiritual, but Holy Spirit is not the spirit that motivates their thought. You got to watch these spiritual people. You got to watch these spooky folk who do it in Jesus' name. Because some folk drop in Jesus' name and Jesus ain't in it. Come on, we ready to go. It's time to go. But I'm not dismissing this service before you obey God. We are not leaving here until you get out of that seat and come to this altar. We're going to wait for you. We don't even know you, but we love you. We don't even know you yet, but we know your life matters. Come on. This is where God wants you to start over. I know you're wrestling with some demons. That's why God sent you to this church, to get you delivered. We know you're not perfect. We know you got some stuff you're still working on. We know. Come on. That's what I'm talking about. People getting excited about people making decisions for Jesus. Who am I waiting on over here? I'm waiting on somebody in this section. Obey God. Welcome home, baby. Somebody say, welcome home. She ain't the only one. Somebody sitting over here was like, ooh, thank God. She just made it easier for you to obey. Come on. There are two of you in this section right here. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on, mama. Come on, mama. There's a man over here too, man of God. Come on. You need to obey God. This is where God wants you to start over. Come on, man of God. Come on. That you? Come on. There he is. Y'all can't see him, but it's a man of God walking the aisle over here. Come on, y'all help me. I need a better hand clap than that. That's a man of God. Woo. Let's get ready to go. Let's get ready. Do me a favor. Ask your neighbor, if you die tonight, you going to heaven or hell? Which one? If they can't answer you, you better drag them to this altar. Look at somebody, tell them, I'm going to heaven, baby. I ain't forgot, Lauren. Tell your neighbor, I'm going to heaven, baby. Somebody over here, though, you ain't show. I'm ready to go. I got a flight. But I ain't leaving until you obey God. You didn't pull me over here. Come on. Hey, y'all. Y'all should have saw his face. He walked out like, dog. Somebody say, welcome home, welcome home. Pastor Deke, where is she at? Did she leave me? She just gonna walk out and leave me? She went with her girl. See, out of order. Out of order. Let's get ready to go. Listen, this Tuesday night, the Tuesday after every first Sunday, we're meeting on the altar. Something started in this room today, and I believe God's going to finish it on Tuesday night. There are many of you who, when she read that scripture, a woman who he had delivered from seven demons, when she read it, something in your spirit was like, ooh, that's me. I want you to meet me here Tuesday night. Those of you who are in the online sanctuary, I want you to be in your designated place Tuesday night at 7:30. Of course, if you're coming early, you're going to text DR Family Meal. Come at, what time we start? 6 o'clock? Come at 6 o'clock, right? 6 o'clock for Family Meal. If you want to come, the kids, just bring them. You don't have to worry about cooking. Come straight to church. We'll have a nice, quality, healthy meal for you. 7:15, we'll transition up into the sanctuary. By 8:30, we'll be dismissing for you to go home. But you do not want to miss the hour of prayer. Will y'all help me thank God this week? Our passion groups began. If you were late for church, I want you to get your phone out. You're going to get your phone out. How many of y'all came to church late today? You were late. Go and tell the truth. Shame the devil. You was late. Get your phone out. I want you to scan this QR code. This week, we are starting our passion group. Somebody said, well, Bishop, what is a passion group? I don't know what that is. Passion groups is how we keep this mega church feeling like a family church, because everybody's connected to a small circle of family and friends. And so you never get lost in this church because you are connected to a passion group. Now, passion groups are not driven by personality. They're driven by passion. So whatever you're passionate about, somebody, you may look at the list of passion groups and say, I don't see my passion here. Good. We're starting passion group leader training in just a few days, I believe. But you want to scan that now. If there's a passion that you don't see that you think our church needs, you need to become a passion group leader. And we're growing our church. Y'all saw, look at all these folk in the choir stand, y'all. Y'all should have saw the altar at 10 o'clock today. We've got to make sure that this, listen, anything that's not growing is dying. So we've got to figure out a way, how do we keep thousands and thousands of people feeling like it's a little storefront family church? This is how we do it, by getting everybody connected to a passion group or to a dream team. So whatever you do, this is what I want you, this is what I need you to do. I need you to get in. Tap your neighbor on the shoulder and say, I need you to get in where you fit in. I think that's it. Did Dr. Alvarado bless you today? I know she blessed me. I know she blessed me today. Last thing I need you to do, we're $130,000 away from meeting our goal of $1 million. All I need for you to do, I said this at the 10 o'clock service, all we need is for 1,300 people. Everybody say 1,300 people. All we need is for 1,300 people to show up next week with an over and above offering of $100, and we will meet our goal. 1,300 people with an over and above seed of $100, and we will meet our goal. Why is this necessary? We got a whole city to build, y'all. And God says, I'm not just going to do it. I need you to have some skin in the game. And so this $1 million is really just a seed to the hundreds of millions that we're going to need to facilitate the vision we have to serve this community in excellence. And so that's what I need you to do. As a matter of fact, let's leave on this note. Look at somebody and tell them, after next week, I'll have to talk in millions. That'll hit you later. The Lord be with you. The Lord keep you. That's my prayer. I love you. I'll see you next week. Sing along. Then a presence, you are satisfied. Yeah,
you are satisfied.
You can't have it if you won't say it. I want you to say this. Every tear has